to all of you. Thank you very much for your response. A warm and hearty welcome to all of you. When I was landing, I saw a gate on the left-hand side at Bandra Airport stating Gateway to the East. So welcome to the Gateway to the East, and that's precisely the theme which we need to leverage and harness. We are really privileged and honored with the personal presence of Additional Chief Secretary Sri Jamashi Sen to be amongst us in this interactive session. It is a great, great opportunity for all of us here who have assembled to take the best out of this session. A hearty welcome to you, sir. A hearty welcome to ADM Calicom, Sri Harishankar ji, who has come all the way from Calicom to this interactive session. A warm welcome to you, sir. A hearty welcome to the NASSCOM Chairman, Eastern Region, Mr. Addl Agarwal, who took his busy time schedule. In spite of his busy schedule, he came all the way to be and to experience, to share his experience with all of us here. A hearty welcome to Mr. Nirupam Sen, Nirupam Chaudhary, Secretary, Eastern Region, NASSCOM, who is actually initiated this idea, and it has now taken a shape that every month we are going across each district to spread, along with NASSCOM, the potential of IT and electronics that can be harnessed for economic growth and prosperity. Siliguri Phase 3 and Bantala. Now, what happens when you create such infrastructure? This infrastructure is a comparable infrastructure across the world. So, in terms of infrastructure assessment, when you want to reach out nationally or internationally, the people who are occupying from this area, he is having the infrastructure that is comparable and competitive for him to be competitive in the international and national arena.
Products are more competitive in the Indian and the international market. So, this is an upside, and this is what is going to create a blend of, you know, cooperation.
I don't know whether you'll be able to answer this question because you're not from North Bengal.
Yeah.
But like the West Bengal government has taken initiatives to start software development. It's been more than 10 years now. But unfortunately, they aren't much of takers. Mm-hmm. I don't understand what is the reason. The ambience is good. There is power. There is everything. Mm-hmm. Then why aren't we getting takers for this? The infrastructure is ready, everything is ready. So where are the takers? And what happens to these people who get trained? What happens to them? Do they get jobs? Are they taken in somewhere? Do they start their own businesses? Nobody knows what happens after a training.
Okay, as you said rightly, that I may not be the best person to answer this question. Maybe some people in the US may be able to answer, but I venture a guess. Okay, one of the important things is an ecosystem. And what I would say is, for whatever reason, although as you said there's been a period of 10 years, the right ecosystem is not there. And so people are possibly finding it more profitable or more appropriate for their careers to move to places where there is an ecosystem, which could be nearby Calcutta, or which could be as far as Bangalore, or it could be as far as the Silicon Valley, depending on what the background of the people is. So it's a little bit of a catch-22, in my opinion. The ecosystem is a kind of a role that has to be played by the government. And that is what I think is happening right now. And at the same time, you know, the local industries, let's say there are a handful of IT industries here, they have to do much more themselves for the local ecosystem. Organize workshops, organize training, without an expectation of any kind of a return, just for the benefit of the ecosystem. Bangalore, for example, went a little that way, but they had an advantage that there were a lot of techie government organizations in that part of the world. So that was a bootstrap point for them. I think it's not late. The people here have to do their best to make sure there is that this place starts to become attractive to IT companies, and the government will also obviously have to do their part. This is my thought. Anybody else would like to venture a guess?
But like the BPOs out here, we got endless candidates for jobs for BPOs out here, especially people from the hills who are already working in BPOs. They are good in the English language and they are good in language skills and all that. So like why does, unlike even I think the BPO first choice, I think they shut down their services, the one that was in Teambati Mall.
First source.
So why is this happening?
Okay. Again, I'm mentioning a guess because I really don't have a concrete answer. See, BPO is a very competitive, and unfortunately, this is if somebody wants to set up a BPO, they're not only facing competition from the rest of India, they're facing now competition for countries such as Philippines, Vietnam. So BPO can be a good bootstrapping activity if you want to, you know, have a cash cow or want to kind of start, but it's not going to be a very long-term strategy for growth. Okay, so what's happening, and it's the customers are flaky. BPO customers are not very loyal customers. The day they find the per seat cost is cheaper somewhere else, they dump you at short notice. So BPO, you cannot have, unless there's a very strategic advantage, a BPO cannot sustain the growth of IT in any region. Ireland could sustain for a long time because they were closest to the east coast of US. That's why Ireland could sustain BPOs for quite a long time, but then obviously other countries started coming in. So I think BPO as a business is not a viable, unless you have some very strategic advantage in when you are doing a BPO, either you're using a lot of automation, or you're catering to such customers that they treat you as the best in the class kind of a thing. Okay, so that's my thought.
Thank you, sir.
Exactly, like apart from typical voice processes, some people are focused towards verticals, right? For example, all of us know there is a good center for actuaries which Golandawali started in this city, in Siliguri. So basically, they are focused towards a particular vertical. There are umpteen examples of companies who are either focused on supply chain, either focused on very niche processes, right? Gone are the days where basically there is price advantage in terms of just voice calls or inbound, outbound, that things, right? So that's exactly the kind of message given from NASSCOM also, let me tell you. This is not just the scenario of North Bengal or for this part of India only. We have a National BPM Council, and that's exactly the question that's being asked in national council levels also all across India. That's the scenario just changed. Okay. So one of the initiatives which has also happened from NASSCOM and some leading BPO companies in India is that they're trying to make entrepreneurs now, train them to make them world-worthy. There's a term called world-worthy. So that means it is not just the voice part or in terms of handling clients, but also understanding the etiquettes, understanding the process, understanding the domains much better, so that they are able to even handle processes with Mandarin support or the French or any other countries, right? So becoming someone, professionals who are not just talking over the phone, but they understand the customer psyche, understand, and they're moving a notch up. beyond just process, the basic purpose for which BPOs originally started, right? So that's
beautiful picture of the Kanchenjunga, and go and tell them it's the foothills, you are done. So where is salt? Why was the tricky area? And that's something that I was getting prepared. So what I did was, I collected the data, and do you guys didn't know about it that time. I collected the data of all the people who are performing in various companies, including mine. And I looked at the performance indicators of the boys and girls of this zone. And I realized that they were outstanding. And when I went to the boardroom, and when I had that data, and when I flashed on the screen, and I said, the best talent are available there, and that was no brainer. And if, and 12 years later, I can tell you, having worked with many people across the country and in many, many countries too, the boys and girls of this locality is phenomenal. I mean, their intelligence is fantastic. Communication, probably the best in the country. Their intellectual capability is amazingly high. Their diligence is fantastic. But there's one quality which not many of us talk about or think about, but is extremely important in a virtual business, is honesty and integrity. And I can tell you that the boys and girls of this place have phenomenal honesty and impeccable integrity, and that's something very, very important in a virtual space. And in my previous company, we were operating on banks, we were working for banking data, and it was very important that I had the right kind of people with the right kind of value system. We started with a modest, like Shorutha mentioned, in our small STPI unit, you know, we got a space there. It was very difficult to even get a bandwidth because it had to cross the railway line, and you know, it was difficult to get the permission to cross a railway line to get my internet bandwidth. I had about 12 people. And then my colleagues did a phenomenal job. They did a fantastic job, and in no time it scaled up to 150. And sir, you talked about a very large company shutting down. So let me make you proud. Do you know that the world's largest HR benefits company operates out of your city, operates out of this building? It's called Aclaris Various Towers Watson. Tower Watson took over Aclaris a few years back at $140 million. It's the largest, world's largest HR benefits company, and today it is operating in your city. And they're operating proudly, and I can tell you, when we were doing the deal and we were trying to sell the whole concept, Siliguri was an integral part of their business deal. When they looked at the boys and girls in the profiles, they said, wow, this is what we need.
So I understand what he's saying. The thing is that I've been doing documentation for the Siliguri Jalpaiguri Development Authority for many years now.
Okay.
And so I've done all their films and all that, and I have the data, and I know the people of this place are capable, because especially from the people of the hills and all that, they're very well versed in a lot of things, and their hospitality is mind-blowing. The thing is that I just wanted one thing, is that why aren't we getting the type of takers that we get in the other cities? What is wrong with this place? It's got a perfect ambience. Everything is there. Then why aren't the people coming?
I try and partly answer that question.
Yeah.
So when I, you know, came out of Aclaris because it was bought over by a large entity, when I started my own new initiatives, I also waited. I waited till March 2018 when we had a very interesting Hill Business Summit, and where we were all assured of certain things that any businessman needs in any environment. We were talked about the peace that is necessary. We were talked about the continuity of business. We were talked about giving us good bandwidth. And it gives us the confidence and the encouragement to now come back and start initiative once again. I always loved this place and I wanted to come back. Now I have the confidence to come back again. And I thank people on the rise for giving us that confidence back. And let me share with you, with all of you, some of our thoughts that we are trying to do. Thanks to that event that happened sometime in March, we met some very prospective business partners who are operating in this area. And with one of them, they are a very, very large entity. And they are here for many years and doing a phenomenal job. I'm sorry, till I sign my agreement, I cannot name them. Certainos. And with them, we are coming out with four very large initiatives, which will be focusing in the hill areas and, of course, my favorite place here too. We'll be working using technology in the areas of health, in the areas of education. Agriculture is going to be very big. We have one initiative called Mati Kotha, where we're working with 7.2 million farmers on a daily basis. We see no reason why we cannot extend that same concept in tea gardens. And if you use technology, phenomenal things are possible. And of course, the thing that I have always been doing, BPM. You know, we have stopped calling it BPO, we call it BPM nowadays. We don't use the word outsourcing, that's a dirty word for many people. We call it business process management. NASSCOM taught us to use BPM. So we're using that word nowadays. So yes, we are going to start health, education, agriculture and BPM in a very large manner in this locality. We're looking at tourism, that's your strength. And can tourism be augmented using technology? Can we come out with homestay apps, which will be easy for people to use? Can we rate them so that a foreigner knows which homestay is rated and something like an OYO? Can we do it in government, West Bengal? Certainly we can. Can it generate employment? Tremendously it can. We have the best manpower out here. They are smart. But yes, to do that, we need some augmentation in certain areas. Bandwidth is certainly one, and you know, our team, our government is looking into it, certainly that's going to happen. The environment, the ecosystem that we all talked about, certainly that will happen. It will grow. I mean, nothing can happen overnight. But you know, you need one fire to ignite. You know, one splinter, the fire is ignited. It's possible to do that. Directly, we all can do that. You know, I've heard questions like, how do I get to know information? Information is at your foot, in your fingertips today. Information flows across the world today. You have it in that 6-inch screen that you have in front of you. I don't think we need to be dependent on any metro city to get information anymore. You talked about CDs. Use cloud. You have to know how to use cloud. You don't get CDs to be sent anymore. You can access the whole global market accordingly. It's a technology and the application of technology that we all need to do collectively. Today, geography is not relevant anymore. We are all connected world. If there is talent, there is opportunity. If there is opportunity, we can grab it using technology. And I'm sure all of you can do that. And entrepreneurship is not easy. It's tough. It has its own challenges. But if we have the will, and the kind of people we have here, I don't see any reason why we cannot succeed. And I'm sharing from my point of view, 12 years back, I started my first BPM. Thank you guys for doing such a fantastic job. And I'm coming back once again. In next 2 to 3 months time, you will see initiatives. Thanks to Dr. Sen, it's supported a lot, and we are able to do a lot of things out here. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for giving this.
Everybody on the dash, actually, I'm jumping the queue. I was supposed to speak at the last, you know, the topic. I have to hear through everybody, then only I can react. But my very good friend, Mr. Kalankar, has to leave at 6:50. And since he's been a great friend and a great entrepreneur and a great developer of this region, I thought I must call her yet before he leaves. Right. See, you can say that the government is not doing anything. But because Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee organized a Hill Summit here in Darjeeling just a couple of months, is therefore Mr. Kalankar is here, and therefore I know what he is doing. We can't say because of commercial secrets and it has not yet been signed, but it's going up very fast. That's why these things are happening. If you say that the government will run business, government will not run business. Government will support you. Government will support you not only for Siliguri. Question asked, why is Siliguri so ugly? It's not ugly. It's great. So is Kalimpong, so is Darjeeling, so is Karsiyong, so is Dinajpur, so is all of Bengal, so is India. So we must see how we can leverage our respective advantages. This is a competitive world. Please don't forget that. Everybody, and since as Mr. Agarwal has very rightly said, in technology, this is very, there are barriers are very low. You can get it very quickly. You can be also, what shall I say, elbowed out very quickly. So constantly you have to run. Constantly you have to upgrade. Constantly you have to know newer things that are happening. You have to know about blockchain. You have to know about artificial intelligence. You have to know about machine learning. You have to know about deep neural networks. You have to know about fintech. Only then you will survive. Nobody will take you for those data processing and other entities. These are being done by bots. Have you seen the Google Duplay by Amasundar Pichai that was done this time in the Google show? The entire booking of a haircut salon, which I presume in US is a very, very difficult thing. Here we only walk in and we get our hair cut. But there it must be a big thing because it was showcased internationally. How an artificial robot is setting up an appointment, and in spite of the humans, let's see if that will be away, kind of the equivalent of that, the bot could understand. And in fact, Google has to give a declaration that this is a robot speaking and not a human being for ethical reasons. Why I am mentioning this? I am mentioning this is because it throws up challenges and this throws up opportunities as well. If we are able to find out an intermediary so that all the tourism industry in this area doesn't have to go online, doesn't have to do artificial intelligence, but one great entrepreneur, person with the orange t-shirt, he will put up one shop that will interpret everything, and all the reservations will happen by simple telephone call, like the good old time, but all through the intermediary of an artificial intelligence. What I am trying to say is that we can have, we should have areas of specialization in this maddeningly rush of changing. What is the government doing about the maddeningly rush changing? Mr. Mukhopadhyay could not compete because of technical errors, but we are creating a network of new age information dissemination centers, training centers, knowledge centers throughout the state of West Bengal so that our young boys and girls know what to do. There's a point up to which you can teach. I was having a meeting with the vice chancellor of the Technical University of Bengal called Makkab, Maulana Azhar University of Technical University. And there was a special IT team formed. There was a very learned professor from the Indian Statistical Institute, and there were many of us together. One of the professors had resigned from Cognizant. He said, my promotion, my job, I am such a good PhD holder, but all I am doing is to keep the records of a bank database safe. So there was frustration. He resigned from Cognizant. He joined the university. He wants to do something big. So we were sitting in this committee and we were wondering how to upgrade to the new level emerging technologies. How many of us truly understand blockchain? Believe me, it's one of the most difficult things. Asymmetric cryptology, you have to understand fully before you even know how you can touch a blockchain. And blockchain is the basis of Bitcoin. And the Bitcoin is what is moving the world. If you have to do artificial intelligence, do you understand neural network? Do you understand deep gradient? Do you understand Boltzmann network? Do you understand machine learning? Do you understand back propagation? These are extremely complex things. So we posed and we asked the vice chancellor, what should be done? What should the government do? You are the educational institution. You are the top person of Bengal, of the technical universities. So what should be done? He said, our professors don't know. Our professors don't know. It's not their fault. When they got their PhDs and other things, these things were not there. Mr. Agarwal told us. When we had started our career, this was the scenario. It was quite different. How different things were 2 years ago, 3 years ago. World is changing so fast. How can knowledge be acquired? I volunteered to say, how about online courses? Coursera is going on, Udemy is going on at the school level, Khan Academy is going on. Why not do this? And the professors scoffed at me. They said, these are just money minting machines. Unless you do hands-on, you will not learn anything. You will only be like the blind person who touches various parts of the elephant and tries to guess what it is. So complex of the thing. So what is the solution? So I talked with Professor P.P. Chakraborty, the director of IIT Kharagpur. We are working very closely because the IIIT, the Indian Institute of Information Technology, the state government has a very great share along with the government of India and one or two industries. So we work very closely, and after talking to the vice chancellor of the Technical University, talking to the director of IIT Kharagpur, Professor Chakraborty, who is also a member of the AI Task Force, National Task Force team, we decided that the only way to train our youngsters is to use the services of the existing researchers, those who are doing PhDs. Only they are current. They constantly have to do something because they are still writing the thesis. In the US, this is done by postdoc. After doctor, after getting their PhD, the postdoctoral, they use them for training assignment. This is how their education in technology field is going on. But in our country, we decided this probably is not going to work. Because everybody after completing PhD for postdoc, they all go to the US and other countries. Why? Because the Trump regime has said and decided that visas will not be given below PhD level. So after PhD to milega, so everybody is going away. So who will teach our youngsters? Postdoc teaching assignments are not there. Current professors don't know. So how will you cope with these intricate new things that are coming up every day? So this is one strategy that we are trying to harness. That if you are still, you have got your graduation, you have got your post-graduation, you have got your MPhil, you are doing a research, you are doing a lot of studies in a certain field, and I know, for example, in these research institutions like the Indian Statistical Institute, even just after doctorate, they are being taken away by the Singapore University. They are just going away. So, very strategically, we are trying to work out a model in which before they are taken away, all our talents are being taken away. Let us try and use them if we can. So this is one thing that we are working on. This has to come in, this has to come everywhere, and we intend through the medium of WIL to go forward. You know, everybody cannot pick it up. But just like the iPhone, he was asking about China CD export. I was also equally amazed, but I think it has been very adequately answered both by Mr. Kaur and Mr. Agarwal. I can't see why he is still in the postcard era. Post offices all over the world have shut down, but he still wants to sell his CD because his client is not understanding. But that's not the point. The point I am trying to say is that in this area, that so much upheaval is taking place, we have to capture the new processes. To come back from an abstract level to the to a slightly more relevant level, in the matter what Mr. Kaur has touched upon, and that is one of the main thing, what I would say, in this region, Mr. Sarkar has been talking repeatedly, why not Siliguri? I have answered first, why not whole of Bengal? We are equally equally friendly and we want all parts of Bengal to come up, which is why we are trying to bring up a IT park in Kalimpong, an IT park in Darjeeling, the third IT park in Siliguri, and all over the place, and we are reaching out. This itself, through you, if you write in your notes, in your Facebooks, in your Twitters, when you go back home and say that this is what we must do, then this will start getting propagated. What it is the message I'm saying? Reskill and upskill, there's no going away. From the government, we are trying to do something, but even otherwise, if you don't do, you will be irrelevant in 24 months' time, make no mistake. Two is specialize. So, this region, Siliguri and its surroundings, anybody's guess is it should be e-commerce. Today, Flipkart has been taken over by Walmart, with such an undisclosed sum, and all these things are coming up. And Siliguri is at the center of all the trade routes in Northeast India, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, and whole of North Bengal. So there should be an absolute absolute specialization on e-commerce, not in the Flipkart kind of a way, not in the Amazon kind of way, but in a very, very intellectual kind of way. Think about smart contracts, for example, which is basically based on blockchain. Do you know that so many imports are going on and so many exports are going on? I am not talking of between countries necessarily, it can be between states as well. But if there is a smart contract, then the outgoes and ingoes in each place can be nullified and everybody can settle their accounts and money very, very easily. There is so much way in which new technology can be harnessed in developing new generation of e-commerce. And that is what Siliguri and its adjoining region should concentrate upon. Leave aside your other things. If you do everything, you will be a master of nothing. That is what is happening is that, for example, next 15th of June, we'll be having a knowledge conference at Calcutta, which we have already had on cybersecurity, on artificial intelligence, on blockchain, and now we are going to have it on embedded technology. And I was reading that these days for mining Bitcoin, computers are no longer, however powerful with the most powerful graphic user interface, also mining is not viable any longer, because day by day the difficulty level is deliberately increasing. So what do you do? In Taiwan there is a thing called S9, and that is a pure hardware design with embedded technology to make only mining. So these are the days of specialization. A computer can do everything, no longer it's going to be valid. A general purpose desktop or a laptop is not good enough for mining Bitcoin. For instance, the S9 miner is dedicated from its birth, from the chip design itself, of optimizing. So likewise, we must concentrate on how e-commerce in this region can be optimized. Do we need to study Facebook profiles for increasing the trade flows, so on and so forth? There's no end to it. My suggestion is Siliguri and its adjoining region should concentrate on e-commerce in all its variants, in its very, very refined variants. Coming to Darjeeling, again, Mr. Kaur has touched upon, Darjeeling and the hills are such a good place, but do you know what is these levels of these days, what is the level at which technology is used for attracting tourism? Suppose a European person, suppose a person from UK wants to come to India. He has only a few glimpses at the Google search or some other place, Lonely Planet or some other place, before he decides where to come. These days, whoever is searching for tourism, his profile will have been matched already. So if he is from UK, it's wise to market Darjeeling as a place of tea gardens, for example, because the British taught us to drink tea. If, on the other hand, he is a visitor from Japan, so show him the Go Monastery, show him all the Buddhist links, and the Japanese will come in hopes. This is the kind of intelligent marketing that people are talking at. Who is looking at your product? Study his profile. It's all there. As Mr. Kaur said, you are talking of, I'm not getting information. Everything is available on the net. You just have to know how to get it, and get it fast, and get it in microseconds. He only have 3 or 4 seconds to decide whether to go to Agra or to Darjeeling. Now, to a Japanese who are very, very frequent travelers throughout the world, almost like people from Bengal and Gujarat, who are very, also very frequent travelers. So they go all over the place. They have money. So when they look at India, are we saying that Darjeeling is also a Buddhist monastery and lots of places where that might interest them? So this is the kind of niche marketing based on artificial intelligence, based on the analysis of social networks, based on his past habits, that is now coming into being. If you want to compete, you have to do there, and then not only Darjeeling, then everybody will come to you. Somebody in Goa wants to market. They will say there is a center up there in Darjeeling who are doing marvelous artificial intelligence enabled tourism potential. Let's go there and we'll market, we'll start marketing Goa. Because please understand, this is the same problem that is faced everywhere. Every person has a different interest. Get into his head. Today the Google knows more about yourself than you know about yourself. It's cliche almost. Once upon a time this was mentioned by Sundar Pichai, but now everybody knows. He knows when you last bought medicine, and they'll try to sell you that again. How many seconds you lingered at a particular advertisement, and they'll try to push it up again. Like that. You have to study him to draw him into tourism, into your area. This is the level that we are talking of. This is where we have to go. This is where we can establish the region as a place of technological skills that can really make a difference in the matter of tourism. Also, not only tourism, for example, in Kalimpong, very clean air, least polluted. And what do you do in a least polluted clean air? You do chip manufacturing. Now, Intel and AMDs you can't do overnight. But please understand, as I got digressed with this, Apple phone was ringing this typical tune. In Apple phone, all Apple phones, iPhones that you find, right? You should see at every iPhone. So these days, nothing is done in one place. It's all a value chain. It starts from one place and ends in another place all over the world. The idea should be to take a segment, very niche segment, very important segment, but be the best in the world in that segment, in the whole value chain. For instance, the other day, Manoj Babu brought to me one person. He says, sir, not even except for Samsung, no other company ever manufactures any mobile in India. They only assemble with screwdriver. But now there's some change in the tax regime, some 10% tax in some cheap level, not that I understand it very well. But he said, now it makes sense to do a bit of redesigning on the silicon chip so that a particular level of hardware is more cheap even from after even more than bringing it assembled from China, because the levy, the tax would make a difference. So now these things are coming up. Because of the overall framework, in the value chain, we can't be an Intel and an AMD overnight. That's out of question. So therefore, in the Kalimpong IT park, where ADM is sitting here, I was just arguing with him. He has already given me 1 acre of land. We have looked into one rented building because it takes years to build a house. So not waiting for that, we are trying to hire something also, and we are also trying to get more places. And while in every IT park we keep the top floor for hardware, there is not much activity, let me confess to you. But we want to make, for example, Kalimpong in some kind of an electronic manufacturing in the hardware chip design segment in the value chain. I'm repeating for the third time, please don't misunderstand me, misquote me, chip designing cannot be done by us. It's far, far, far advanced. So, but can we not take a small step in the value chain? This is the problem. This is the issue that I want to flag. This is the strategy that we want to get. And this is the strategy that we want to emphasize on. So, while I can go on and on, I will end by saying that if we want to also promote a place, let us organize. The chambers are there, CIA is there, NASSCOM is there. I went to a new town school last month, and they were organizing a TED talk. We have all seen ideas that change. TED talks are all very familiar, very important. Let us organize a TED talk on how to make technology change. There's a way, you don't have to pay anything. But immediately in the eco space, in the whole virtual space, you get vibes that TED talks are happening in Siliguri, in Kalimpong, in Darjeeling. Why don't you organize a TED talk soon? Would you do that? ADM is promising me to do that. Not an you have done?
No, we'll do it in Darjeeling.
Kuch nahi hai, but you know, kind of exposure globally you get.
Yes.
And you know, these days, people write in their biographies, I am a TED speaker.
Right.
Do you know that? I am a TED speaker. It becomes a, you know, if you get a chance to speak in a TED talk, yes, they have certain guidelines and, you know, same things like that. So it's good. Your people learn to speak. The communication is very important. And your place gets a global recognition. You are trying to pull up your space. Place. Why don't you do these kinds of things? So what I am saying is, therefore, we will help you, we will come to you, we will listen to your problems, we will listen to your suggestions, but please ask your youth to get A, specialization, B, upgrade their skills, and then let's create an environment that will bring the very best of our technological skills to the world. So with this, I thank you. The seminar will go on. As I said, it was an inclusion in honor of